Good morning. Welcome once more to our Friday morning prayers. Good to be with you again. It's a bit of a miserable day out there, but never mind. At least we're privileged to be in the warm and the dry, like a lot of people out there in the world. Let's just take a few moments to come into his presence, to still our hearts and minds. Open ourselves to what he might say to us this morning. Well, it's so good to have a relationship with our God, isn't it? He does speak. Let's begin, shall we, with our prayer from Augustine. Grant me, even me, my dearest Lord, to know you and love you and rejoice in you. Let the love of you grow every day more and more in me, that my joy may be full in you. Then our Northumbrian prayer. One thing I've asked of the Lord, this is what I seek, that I might dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. So if you could respond after me, after I ask the question. Who is it you seek? We seek the Lord our God. Do you seek him with all your hearts? Amen. Lord, have mercy. Do you seek him with all your soul? Amen. Lord, have mercy. Do you seek him with all your mind? Amen. Lord, have mercy. Do you seek him with all your strength? Amen. Lord, have mercy. To whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life, and we have believed and come to know that you are the Holy One of God. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory. So our psalm this morning is Psalm 141. And we're going to be continuing in Galatians chapter 5. So first of all, Psalm 141. O Lord, I call to you. Come quickly to me. Hear my voice when I call to you. May my prayer be set before you like incense. May the lifting up of my hands be like the evening sacrifice. Set a guard over my mouth, O Lord. Keep watch over the door of my lips. Let not my heart be drawn to what is evil, to take part in wicked deeds, with men who are evildoers. Let me not eat of their delicacies. Let a righteous man strike me. It is a kindness. Let him rebuke me. It is oil on my head. My head will not refuse it. Yet my prayer is ever against the deeds of the evildoers. The rulers will be thrown down from the cliffs, and the wicked will learn that my words were well spoken. They will say, as one ploughs and breaks up the earth, so our bones have been scattered at the mouth of the grave. But my eyes are fixed on you, O Sovereign Lord. In you I take refuge. Do not give me over to death. Keep me from the snares they have laid for me, from the traps set by evildoers. Let the wicked fall into their own nets, while I pass by in safety. We need all the help we can get sometimes, don't we? Trying to live an upright life. Sometimes our thoughts can be conflicting and distracting, and temptations can fall in our way. So we need to be able to say sorry to God for those times, don't we? To renew our relationship with our God. And it helps us be aware of what Jesus has done for us, knowing that by nature we are sinful, but God forgives us through his Son, Jesus Christ. What an amazing privilege we have. So let's join together in saying some prayers of repentance for the things we've done wrong in the past week. Let's just take a moment to reflect on those times when we have got it wrong and said or done something that isn't good. So may the power of your love, O Lord, fire in sweet as honey, wean our hearts from all that is under heaven, that we may die for the love of your love, you who were so good as to die for love of our love, that we may live joyfully a life of simplicity and humble service. So let us confess our sins and rejoice in our utter dependence on God. So we say together, most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been and help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy and walk humbly with you, our God. May the God of love and power forgive us and free us from our sins, heal and strengthen us by his Holy Spirit, and raise us in new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. So we're continuing to look at Galatians. We're in chapter 5 and it's verses 1 to 26. Freedom in Christ. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. Mark my words, I, Paul, tell you that if you let yourselves be circumcised, Christ will be of no value to you at all. Again, I declare to every man who lets himself be circumcised that he is required to obey the whole law. You who are trying to be justified by law have been alienated from Christ. You have fallen away from grace. But by faith, we eagerly await through the Spirit the righteousness which we hope. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision has any value. The only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. You were running in a good race. Who cut in on you and kept you from obeying the truth? That kind of persuasion does not come from the one who calls you. A little yeast works through the whole batch of dough. I am confident in the Lord that you will take no other view. The one who is throwing you into confusion will pay the penalty, whoever he may be. Brothers, if I am still preaching circumcision, why am I still being persecuted? In that case, the offence of the cross has been abolished. As for those agitators, I wish they would go the whole way and emasculate themselves. You, my brothers, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge in sinful nature. Rather, serve one another in love. The entire law is summed up in a single command: love your neighbour as yourself. If you keep on biting and devouring each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed by each other. So I say, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. For the sinful nature desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the sinful nature. They are in conflict with each other, so that you do not do what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under law. The acts of the sinful nature are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions and envy, drunkenness, orgies and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the sinful nature with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking and envying each other. Powerful statements, eh? So it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Amen. It's like we don't know how to cope with this freedom. Like the Christians in Galatia, we want to put restrictions on ourselves, saying we need to abide by rules. But Paul is saying no. If we live by faith in what Jesus has done for us, then we are under grace, and this doesn't demand anything of us. When we can accept this, then we can't help but love. If we try to put ourselves back under laws, then we are saying that Christ's sacrifice was for nothing. In effect, we are back where we started, under law. This law that was there to show us that our best efforts were just not good enough for making ourselves right with God. So in order to achieve that, we would need to have kept all the laws, not just the law of circumcision. So in coming back under law, we are turning our backs on God's full provision of grace. But if we live by faith, then we have hope in the Spirit that makes us righteous. It doesn't matter about circumcision, whether we're circumcised or not. All that counts is faith, lived out in love. Paul says all this deception is the work of the evil one, because it doesn't come from God. And those who are causing this deception will be punished. And Paul says something that doesn't sound very Christian at all, wishing they would go the whole way and castrate themselves. He goes on to remind us that we are called to be free. However, we must not use that freedom to indulge our sinful nature, but we should serve one another in love. Love sums up our calling, to love our neighbour as ourselves. If we can't do this and instead cause division, then we are causing our own destruction. So we must live by the Spirit, and in doing so, we will not gratify our sinful nature, the sinful nature that desires what is contrary to the Spirit. The Spirit and our sinful nature are ever at battle with each other. We must be led by the Spirit, and this enables us to resist the temptations of our sinful nature. In so doing, we will have the fruit of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. So if we're in Christ Jesus, we have crucified our sinful nature. So therefore, let us keep in step with the Spirit by living through the Spirit which is in us. And this produces love. If only the people of the world would turn to Christ and accept his love and forgiveness. Wouldn't it be amazing to see everyone have love for each other, to realise that we're all connected one to another and we should love each other? What a different world we'd be living in. But thankfully, one day we should be joining Christ, when we will all live in love and peace and harmony. How amazing will that be? We just give you thanks, Lord Jesus, for making this possible. No, it's just beyond our thinking, Lord, how God and creator of the universe would succumb to being a man so that he could restore our relationship, to become one of us. Lord, we are so unworthy of that mercy in our lives, but by faith we accept it. Just help us to be better people for you, to love our neighbour as ourselves. We ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. So let's turn to prayer, shall we? Lord, you have called us to know you. You have called us to love you. You have called us to serve you. You have called us to proclaim you. Guide and strengthen us by your Spirit. Make us worthy of our calling, that we may live to your praise and glory through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the same Spirit, one God forever. Amen. So the refrain for our prayer today is, when I say, Lord, as you have called us, if you could respond with, make us worthy of our calling. Holy Father, strengthen each in their vocation and ministry. Help us to see how we need each other and to share the talents and abilities which you give us. guide by your Holy Spirit all who are called to ordination. We pray for theological colleges, for tutors and students, for all who are seeking to serve others. Lord, as you have called us, make us worthy of our calling. Grant grace to all who care for others in their daily work. We pray for doctors, nurses and ambulance workers, for the fire brigade and the police and social workers. We remember also shopkeepers and bakers. Lord, that each of them may show love and care in their actions. Lord, as you have called us, make us worthy of our calling. We give you thanks and praise for all who have cared for us. Bless with your goodness our homes and loved ones. Strengthen us in the service of our community. Guide us that we may bring joy and peace to others. Lord, as you have called us, make us worthy of our calling. Holy and strong one, be a comfort to all who have been hindered in living their lives to the full. We remember all of whose vocation has been thwarted through illness, through poverty, through the prejudice of others. We pray for all who are unemployed or have been made redundant, for all who feel their lives are being wasted. We pray for all we know that are in sickness or weakness. Let's just take a moment to lift those people to the Lord. Lord, I pray for Chris Rowe at this time. Pray for a swift healing, Lord, and a good response to her treatment. Bless her and Pete at this time. Give them your peace. Lord, as you have called us, make us worthy of our calling. We give you praise for all who have fulfilled their work on earth and now serve before you in your glorious kingdom. Let's pray for our loved ones departed. So Lord, we pray once more for the Campbells who are mourning the loss of Colin. Just hold them in your loving arms, Lord. Help them through this time. Be with them. May they know your presence surrounding them. Lord, as you have called us, make us worthy of our calling. Let's just join together in the Lord's Prayer, shall we? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Oh. Thank you for joining me once more this Friday morning. Hope you've got a good day planned ahead. Hopefully it'll brighten up a bit later on. But enjoy your day and have a great weekend. maybe see you at St. Barnabas on Sunday morning or the coffee morning tomorrow. But take care. But before we go, we must have a blessing, mustn't we? God is ever close at hand. His kingdom is near. Come and enter into his love and peace. A blessing from Numbers. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you his peace. Peace be with you. Have a great weekend. See you next Friday. Love you all. Bye.